Okay, we're just going to be talking about thermodynamic cycle analysis. The last two classes we've talked about Carnot cycle. So you should have three sheets of paper. One of them is a list of tables. I skipped the front of the room, you guys. I didn't even know there was this desk here. So when those get done in the back, please bring those back up to the front so that I can give them to the people in the front, because they are without handouts right now. Is the mic off now? Audio. Hello. Still there?
I'm not going to worry about this.
I'll just talk about it.
I hear you.
There you go. Okay. So in particular, let's just start with the problem we're going to be working on today, and then I can walk through the steps. We're going to look at a sort of gas turbine example, and in particular, we're going to be looking at a turboprop engine on an airplane. So the way this sort of works, we have a propeller, pulls in air, which then goes through a compressor, and then go through a combustor, and a turbine, which is where we generate power, and then we go out through a nozzle. About the steps that you should go through, and the first of those steps is to draw a schematic, which is what we have here, of the diagram and cycle components. Start with point one and then go through the different points that we're going this direction. And then you want to set up a table with all your different states, and that's how you're going to sort of keep track of the different info you need to solve this problem. So, start with our states. You don't just have the actual states, but you also have the isentropic states, because what you're kind of keeping track of is the difference between how the cycle would behave actually versus how it would behave if all of the parts were isentropic. So we look at this on like a TS diagram. You get something like this. These are your lines of constant pressure. Isentropic processes are straight up and down, but in reality, you're getting something like that, where it's increasing in entropy. So let's say this is state one. Go through this compressor, get compressed. This would be like state 2S, and this would be state 2 actual. This would be state 3 after we go through the combustor, so we have constant pressure heating. Then if we go down here isentropically, we would have isentropic expansion. But actually we have actual expansion. So we go back to our original state. It's sort of tricky because we're not actually, especially in this one, this is it's an interesting use of the term cycle, because this air that goes out here does not get recycled back here, but we're just always pulling in new air from this point, essentially. And when we reject this air, we're assuming it goes back to that temperature, so that's where it's sort of a cycle, in that sense. So, all we gotta do for this problem is sort of fill out the states and find the stuff that Dr. Weber wrote on this air brake cycle analysis page, and then we're done for the day. So what he asked for was for us to find, given a altitude of 30,000 feet, inlet conditions of 50 kPa and minus 50 degrees C, compressor pressure ratio of 20, isentropic efficiency of the compressor is 80%, 1800 degree combustion, or I guess that's the turbine inlet, and then the isentropic efficiency of the turbine is 90%. And with that information, he wants us to find the mass flow rate of the air required to get 5,000 kilowatts out, the net power out, overall cycle efficiency, compressor work ratio, and fuel flow rate.
So he says the first step is to make a table of our states. We've got state one, we've got 2S, 2A, 3, 4S, and 4A. We have our pressures, most of which are already given to us, all of which are already given to us. We're operating between 30 and 600 kPa because our pressure ratio is 20. So we started at 30 kPa, and then it said we had a compression ratio of 20, so that's how we know that our other pressure is 600 kPa. So how do we find our temperature? Well, we know two of our temperatures. We know that we're starting at minus 50 degrees C, and that the temperature on the inlet of the turbine is 1800 degrees C. We can go ahead and label these parts too. This is compressor inlet. This is compressor out. This is turbine. This is. Okay. So for each of these things, we need to be able to fill out basically the main thing we're looking for is the H's. So which H's do we need? We can start by figuring out what the equations are for the different things that we need to solve for and figure out which H's we need. So we need the network output. We can do just a analysis around this CS diagram to figure out what the network is. So we know that we're looking for the mass flow rate. We know that the work needs to be 5,000 kilowatts. So we know that's 5,000 kilowatts. We know that our work in is the difference between the entropy at the inlet and the outlet of the turbine. So that's H3 minus H4A. And this is our work out by the turbine. And then we want to subtract from that the work produced, the work input to the compressor. And then using this, we can say, okay, well, we know W dot net. So if we know W dot net, then this mass flow rate is equal to W dot net over these enthalpies. And we should be able to find the enthalpy of 3 and the enthalpy of 1 because we already know the temperature and the pressure. Go ahead, find those guys from our table, and we get 223.7. These are kilojoules per kilogram. And 24.49 over here. So we'll keep filling out this table as we go. I just want to get all the different equations on the
port.
So this is the equation for finding the mass flow rate of air. Once we have that mass flow rate of air, we can find the Q in, which we need to find the efficiency. So, and once we have H2A. So we already have H3, we need H2A. Once we know H2A and the mass flow rate of air, we can find the efficiency by saying that it's equal to the net power output over the heat input, which is equal to the net power output over in that H3 minus H2A. We still need H2A to find that. Once we have that, we can find the compressor work ratio. That's just the ratio of the work into the compressor over the work out in the turbine. So that would be H2A minus H1 over H3 minus H4A. Does that look right? And then that last thing we need is the fuel rate, which we already have here. We would basically say that Qn is equal to mdot times H3 minus H4A, which is also equal to, this mdot is the air. We say the mdot of the fuel times the heating value of the fuel. And then we can find mdot fuel by dividing this energy transfer to the air by the heating value. Have y'all ever seen this heating value equation before? Okay. So what we're saying here is this is in like kilojoules per kilogram, and they have that listed on your handout. So where it says heating value is 42,500 kilojoules per kilogram, if we multiply that by the flow rate, we get our Q dot in. This is basically at what rate is the fuel providing heat to this air, which is moving this fast and changing in energy this much. So here's all, these are basically the equations we need to find what Dr. Weber is asking for. And we have H3, but we don't have H4A or H2A. So now we need to figure out how we can get H4A and H2A. So we know that our pressure difference, we have this compression ratio of 20. So we can say P2, maybe make more. Let's see, I'll find a good place. So we can say P2 over P1 is equal to 20. And for an isentropic process, we can say that's equal to P2 over P1 with these O's on top and these non-dimensional pressures. If we find our P1, we can say that the P1 here is equal to 0.4979. And you can get that off your table. So then using that, we can say that P2 is equal to 20 times 0.4979, which is equal to 9.958. And you can use that, basically you pull this up in your table to get your isentropic temperature and enthalpy. So now we can say that T2S is equal to 249 degrees C. And H2S is 527. And then we can use our isentropic efficiency of the compressor to find our actual temperature in. So now we can say W isentropic over W actual is equal to 0.8. It's equal to H2S minus H1 over H2A minus H1. We know H2S and H1. So from that, we can get H2A is equal to 603 kilojoules per kilogram. And that our temperature at that point is equal to 324 degrees C. Does that make sense?
Did you guys ever get handouts? Can someone pass some handouts down to the front? Where's the stack of that stuff? Let's see some stacks. Similarly, we can do the same thing with the turbine that we just did with the compressor. So we can go ahead and say all of this is for the compressor. And we'll do the same thing with the turbine. We can say that P4 over P2 is equal to P4 circle thing over P2 circle thing. And then when we get there, we know that found P2 from over there. This should be P3. Right. Yep. Cool. So now we would say P3 hat is equal to 2449. That's not right. Those are 0.8. This P3 is 2449.8, then we're going to get efficiency and T equals 0.9 equals H3 minus H4S over H3 minus H4A. And use that to find H4A. Make this a little easier. We had this set up to start with. This is an air standard Brayton cycle. So we know, because it's a Brayton cycle, sort of the order of operations we're going to have. We're going to have compression, where we can evaluate it either isentropically or actually. So based on its isentropic efficiency, we can sort of get an idea of the actual performance of this compressor based on the temperatures and pressures that it's operating under. We're gonna have a combustor, and this is constant pressure, so you're gonna stay on these sort of constant pressure lines. And then we have a turbine, which is also something that we can evaluate isentropically, and then using the isentropic efficiency, we can figure out its actual performance, and then we get back to our original state. We blow that air out, it's back to its original state, we're pulling more in, it's at its original state, we have a full cycle where overall there's zero power energy changes, essentially. What we did, once we found these equations, we went ahead and figured out which equations we were going to need to solve the problems, and then saw where the different enthalpies we needed were that we didn't already have. So when we started, we knew H1 and H3, we didn't know H2A or H4A. So all of these equations, if you know your enthalpy at all four states, you can solve for all of this stuff, but we had to find our enthalpies at states 2 and 4 before we were able to do any of that. And then all I did over here, using these non-dimensional pressures. Another way to do this that y'all aren't really learning because you're not using all the interpolation and stuff, if you're not using one of these the way we sort of used to do it is, okay, we know that what the pressure is. Assuming something is at a certain pressure and has the same entropy as our original state, what would its temperature have to be? So essentially, the way we would do it is you'd go to the table, you'd know what the pressure is, and then you'd interpolate for what temperature at that pressure has the same entropy as the original state. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so you start at some entropy, you go up to some pressure, and then what temperature must that be corresponding to that entropy and pressure? So we did that. We used our isentropic efficiency of our compressor and our turbine to find the actual enthalpy on the outside of the turbine. The isentropic enthalpy is, you know, what I was just describing. So that process is pretty much exactly the same for the compressor and for the turbine. Any questions?
Let's see. Make sure.
All right, yeah, that's pretty much all I've got for you. If it's a closed cycle, you do this with U's instead of with H's, but if it's an open cycle, you do it with H's. That's all I got today.